appreciate, I want to thank Mr. Wells and everyone for inviting us here from the Senior Center. There was a group of folks that you all interact with all the time, who I really want to thank, who came over the summer and recruited us, Mrs. Coakley and Mrs. Brandeis, to come. So they were fantastic. And this is, you know, we have three really great programs that we've been able to develop over the last couple of years in the Senior Center, the Voter Forum, the Seniors Back to School, which we last week, if you'd love to come, please come. We do it again in the spring and in this program, and they have all really come out of the brains of Mrs. Brandeis and Mrs. Coakley and some of the other staff here, and they've just been fantastic. So I just wanted to just very quickly introduce to you some of our high school teachers who are here, who brought their kids. Mrs. O'Brien did all the catering for today. She is probably hiding in the kitchen somewhere. But her students in the breadboard class in high school did all the catering. It's awesome. Their food is awesome. And they love it. Mr. Bernardo is one of our music teachers at the high school, and he provided and works with the jazz combo that was playing out in the hallway there. And they'll play again after the show or during the gallery walk. And then our two high school art teachers, Ms. Field, who is in the back of the room, and Mrs. Lyman, who is somewhere there. They were wonderful and brought their AP art students. So we have about 60 kids here today in total. So we're really thrilled for the opportunity. I don't think there's more. And thank you all the staff here, and introduce Ms. Brandeis.
Thank you. Thank you, Jim. Hello, everyone. I'm Andrea Brandeis. I'm program coordinator here, and I want to share the backstory with you. So on a very cold, snowy January morning, before our balance exercise class began, Arthur told me about an art show he was planning in Maine this summer. I expressed an interest. With a twinkle in his eye, he gave me some homework to do, Google Manuel Rincon and Harper 5, and watch the YouTube videos online. So I did. At the next balance class, Arthur arrived with a box of the Harper 5 booklets, and he passed one out to each member of the balance class. That morning, we exercised a little less and enjoyed our books and a few of Arthur's stories. We asked him if he would do his art show here. What started as a conversation before balance class on that snowy morning has turned into this very special day. One man's collection over the years, art show, gallery talk, and reception with Arthur Wills, a beloved and active member of our community at the Senior Center. Today's program is our third program to come out of our balance class in the last 6 weeks. A Day in the Life of a Diplomat and the Duxbury Cranberry Festival were also balance class programs. Duxbury High School students, we are beyond thrilled that you are here. Thank you for coming. I encourage you to lean in and listen closely to Arthur as he tells stories about relationships and experiences in his life as they relate to art. Every single day at the Senior Center, I learn from our seniors. It is how I grow and how I experience humanity. I believe this will happen for you here today. This program would not be possible without the partnership of Duxbury High School under the leadership of Jim Donovan, the interim principal who we love to collaborate with on intergenerational programs. A special thank you to Stacy and Breadboard students, the art students and their art teachers, the jazz trio, their teachers, Brooke, the journalism student who will be writing about Arthur in this event, and a huge thank you that isn't enough to thank the talented Craig Bloodgood, curator at the Art Complex Museum, our new friend and partner. Craig curated this show and transformed this room into an art gallery, which is usually the dining room. Thank you to Karen Koukouris and Thayer Academy for lending us the easels and the pedestals for the show, and to Peter and Sharon Andrews for their time in helping us prepare and plan and carry everything. Thank you to Arthur Wills and Hannah Bolton for enriching our lives in so many ways. And thank you to my colleagues for their hard work, collaboration with me on this program, and especially to Steve, who is our very own in-house MVP. And the DPW staff, it truly takes a village at the Senior Center. I'm going to turn the program over to Hannah, who will introduce Arthur.
Thank you. done half of my talk, so this is great. I was going to thank everyone at the Senior Center who helped with this, and the volunteers, and Craig Bloodgood, and my husband. But I had asked if I could introduce Arthur, or Al, because I think the only other time I've introduced him was 20 years ago to my family. I don't know which will be more daunting. But in any case, can you hear me?
Yes.
When we were introduced, it was a fix-up. And the woman said to me, "Oh, you have so much in common. You both love to travel and you love art." And indeed, we did. We do. And Arthur, nobody calls him Art. And he doesn't think he's an artist. However, I would like to show one of his paintings. Now, if you've seen portraits in this room of Manuel Rincon, you will recognize how lifelike this is. And I think Arthur really is an artist at heart. So, with further ado, I would like to welcome you to the podium, love.
Show, isn't it? So, how did I get started on this art business? How did I get started on this adventure? And I think it was at Harvard Summer School, because I was pre-med and I was a miler, and I had to travel a lot because I had to run in races all over the country. You can't hear?
Yeah,
there you
go. Good. Right by the mouth.
Oh, well.
Hold it up.
Okay.
You have to sing next.
So, anyway, I had to take physics in summer school, which was attended by Tiffany Albright and a few other people that I knew, and because we traveled a lot as athletes, and we had to get rid of physics because we were both going to go into medicine. So I got in there and I said, physics, oh God, I hate physics. I mean, I don't mind physics. I just don't, I hate to do all the math and all those things. And so I sort of, okay.
You want me to hold it?
No.
Keep it up there.
So I took a class in modern art, and a guy from Williams, I think it was, gave the lectures, and it was just fabulous. And I sort of got more interested in modern art than I did in physics. And I got 110 in that course. But physics, I didn't do so well in, but I guess I got well enough to get into medical school. So anyway, as it turned out, then I came along and at that point, I started practicing medicine with my father after medical school. And people kept wandering in who were artists and so forth and so on. And then Gay Yauss, whose portrait is here by Jack Wolfe, was running the Bumpus Gallery as the custodian, and and she kept inviting artists from Boston down on a monthly basis, and she had 12 shows a year. I often would entertain them in my farm in Marshfield, and then we would have a party, and sometimes they would, and I got to be friendly with them. Lloyd Lilly and other people, Iso Papo, Jason Berger, Marilyn Powers, and that whole group of artists over there who are the direct vision. And so we became very good friends, and we used to have parties at the farm. Last Friday of every month, we had a lot of musicians in that group, Jason Berger played the saxophone, and Lloyd Lilly was a pianist, and Bruce Anderson was another pianist, and then I was the bass fiddle player, but I didn't even know how to, you know, I had no idea how to play it. But we played it along, and, you know, we had a great time, and we made love and not war in that period of our century. And pretty soon, you know, we evolved into a pretty neat little group. Today I'm going to start with this painting over here, which is an N.C. Wyeth. It says Robin Hood on this. I think my wife exaggerated. I think it's mostly likely. I'm not sure who it is, but I know it's N.C. Wyeth. And it started out, I went to an auction in Marshfield, and this painting was a half a painting. It was cut in half. In other words, I'm the victim right here. So this side of the painting, this side of the painting was missing. So I lugged it home, and I bought it for $35. And it had two other paintings with it. They were sort of kind of impressionist paintings, and they weren't very good. But in any event, this one, I said, I think that's an N.C. Wyeth. And so then the things started to happen. I took the painting up to Maine, first chance I got, and I showed it to Walt Anderson, who is a subject of many of Andrew Wyeth's paintings, and Crow Morris, the harbor master, who said, I saw him painting that, he said, I saw him painting that picture. So, he said, well, take it over to Carolyn, and Carolyn may know something about it. And Carolyn was Andrew's sister, and she lived in Eight Bells, which is the N.C. Wyeth homestead. There's a picture of Eight Bells in the, I think it's over here. This is Eight Bells over here, and it's about 400 yards from my summer house on Harper Island, Maine. And so we took it over to Carolyn, and I was with Walt Anderson, and Walt wasn't too popular with Carolyn because, well, he was the town drunk. I mean, he was the town drunk. He would start with a Pabst Blue Ribbon, and then he'd go on from there for breakfast. But he was never drunk. He was just inebriated. And so we took it over to Carolyn, and Carolyn looked at us, and she looked at us, and she didn't like Walt very much, and she just said, I think it's a copy. I think it's just a copy or something. And it's, well, she said, maybe it possibly, but no, it isn't. My brother would never paint any, my father would never paint anybody as stern looking as this guy. So I said, okay, now I'm going down. Then we took it up to the Farnsworth Museum in Rockland. And they looked at it, and these people came out of the back rooms and so forth, and they said, oh my, this is a good painting. It's not a copy. This is an authentic painting, but you have to take it to Andy Wyeth to make sure. So we set it up for an appointment to go and see this. And now in the meantime, Crow Morris has started a little rumor in town. He said, Al Wills has got a, he found this painting up over the eaves in his house on Harper Island, along with five bags of gold, which totally infuriated the man who I bought the summer house from, because he missed it. So anyway, that became kind of a marching song, and we took the painting over to Andrew us, and we got in there, and we go into the vestibule and go in, oh, by the way, first of all, Walt tells me to park behind that truck over there. So I did, and by God, the truck backed right up into me. And Andrew was walking across from his studio in Cushing, Maine, and he just started laughing and laughing and laughing, and he said, "Oh, same thing happened to my daughter a week ago." I mean, it ruined my Mercedes. So we go in there, and Walt and I had already, and then we got into this little breezeway into the house, and there's this painting up here, up to the right, and I say, Walt says, "Well, what you been doing, Andy?" And this was a painting of a seagull on a rock pooping. And he said, "Shit." So that was the end of that little encounter. And then we went in and had a few scotches and so forth and so on. And in the meantime, Pro Morris's story is getting pretty good now. So he says, "Well, you know, they had a few scotches, and then finally Andrew Wyeth got up, went up in his attic, and got the other half of the painting."
Oh, my goodness.
So that was quite a story, and I forget if there's anything more I should say. Yes, there is. You know, then I was driving out of town in my boat, and I had Amy with me, and he said, Pro Morris was out there in the middle with an outhouse in the back of his boat. And he waves me over and he says, "Have you ever had so much fun with your clothes on in all your life?" So anyway, then I got the painting totally restored and framed as it is now. And then I took it back over to Andrew Wyeth's house. He's right across in that house right there. Right over there in Herringgut. And we took it right over to his studio right up on the shore there. And by God, he says, "You know, my sister, she's terrible. She just told you a fib. That's not a copy, that's an N.C. Wyeth painting." And it's before he studied with Howard Pyle. So it was earlier than it says on the painting. So anyway, he then told us a story about how a copy. He said, "I have a good friend in Philadelphia who went over to Italy and he bought this beautiful, beautiful Renaissance painting, but he couldn't bring it back. They painted another painting over it because you can't bring any antique works out of Italy." And so he painted a fast watercolor over the top of this painting and brought it home and brought it to the restorer in Philadelphia. And by God, he said, "I'll be back in a week and we're going to look at this thing and see how it came out." There's a beautiful Renaissance painting in the back of this, right under this watercolor. So be very careful as you restore this. And so he came back a week later to get this painting. And he said, "The first layer came off very fast. The second layer came off very fast. And there was a picture of Mussolini." So that's a true story told by Andrew Wyeth to Amy and I at that time. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about this painting here, which is Marjorie Conant Bushbrown's painting. She painted this early in the 20th century. She studied with Monet, and this is Monet's niece. And I used to take care of Marjorie Conant in Duxbury. I never charged her anything because I couldn't be bothered, you know, it was just too much trouble to build it. So they just gave me this painting after a while. So that was the story of that painting. And I thought that was pretty good. And I've had this in my farmhouse in Marshfield for a long time. So then we kind of move on to Jack Wolfe, who did these two paintings. This is Robert Frost.
Yeah.
It's a study for the poetry reading room in BU, which is a big painting similar to this. And this painting was painted after my son was killed in Alaska in a tragic water skiing accident. And Jack Wolfe painted this for me, and it just showed up in my office. And Bruce Anderson also sent another painting in to me, a little man, little boy with a flag going way out with a kite, way out alone with a kite. And that was another painting that I got because of my son's death. Now this painting is of Gay Youngs by Jack Wolfe. And he didn't want to sell it, but I said, I need it, I have to have it, because I live in Duxbury, and this lady has been pretty influential in bringing all these nice painters down to Duxbury, to the Bumpus Gallery. So she was very good about bringing all of these painters down here, and I got to know them because I used to have parties at my farmhouse in Duxbury, and you know, pretty soon I got to know them pretty well, and we had the band and everything, and it was great. Now, the people who used to come to this were Thomas A. Barron, Adam J. Berger, Jason Berger, Marilyn Powers, Frank Carboni, and Athiana, and SS, I don't remember his name. But anyway, they were part of a group of paintings called the Direct Vision. And they thought they had revolutionized modern art. And Jason's work is further down on that wall. And by gosh, I don't have any other paintings except that this one by anybody other than Jason and Marilyn Powers. But they're all deceased, and so it's kind of too bad. It's the way it goes. But the Direct Vision is still alive to some extent, and I think it might be worth looking it up a little bit, because they're pretty famous as a group. Now, Gay Youngs, painted the Sarah Wingate Taylor house over here on the left, which is on Clark's Island. And she also painted this picture from Korea, Maine. And she was really, she never thought the painting was good enough to sell. So she really, she occasionally sold one or two because she, you know, needed to go to the dentist or something. So I picked up a few of her paintings, but we had these parties at the house, and it was great. And now, this painting is by Luke Randall, and he's in the book. And this painting is called, it's called Peter's House, because my son was named Peter. Mm-hmm. He lived with me, and he was killed in 1986. And this was painted shortly thereafter. And he said, Luke Randall said to me, Peter was talking to me the whole time that I was painting that picture. So that painting, and you could see that it has universal light. There's no, and it's a, you can't tell where the light is, but it's all universal. And it's kind of a spiritual painting for me. Then we go along and we start the I think we should do the rest of the Hupper Five now. And Sue McNally, who painted Harry Got Here, and her painting way in the back has the Forrest Gump lighthouse in it that he ran up as he was rolling around the country. And that's my house in Maine. And then I think we should talk about Bruce Anderson, who did the Knapsack Pins portrait as you came in the door. And and I used to, and Bruce Anderson had terrible, terrible, terrible panic attacks. And he couldn't go from one building to another without checking all the exits, everything, checking it out. His girlfriend came up to me and he said, and she said, will you see Bruce? And I said, sure. And I'll have to drag him in because he hates doctors and he hates going to doctors and he hates going to new buildings. And so he came up and she said, talk to him about blimps. So I said, okay. I know a lot about blimps. They used to fly over my house during the war. But anyway, so I sort of fudged the first meeting and talked about blimps. And if you see those two paintings way in the back, one is of my farm, and the other one is of my office in downtown Boston before I moved back into the hospital. And you notice that they all have blimps, they all have dirigibles in there. And that became his trademark. He always put a dirigible in every one of his paintings after that. So then I think that painting is in the book or not.
Yes.
And and Manuel Roncon, who passed away about, I don't know, we don't know what his death date is. We had a show up in Maine this summer and trying to you know, just make sure that nobody forgot who Manuel was. It turns out that Manuel used to come up from Venezuela once every year, and finally he didn't renew his visa. And then the fellow who ran the country, Chavez, wouldn't let him out of the country. And he ended up having brought up all these paintings through the years to my house, and so I have a few of them. But we've had a big show of his work up in Maine this summer. And I think that pretty much covers everything, except for those two little things there of David that fails. Does anybody read Henry Bear's art, the children's book? Sculptors, my wife likes my sculptors more than she likes me.
We know that it's painting.
Yeah, well, anyway, he did El Toro, which is the bull, and then he did a head, and we sort of ignored Lloyd Lilly's sculptures here. Thomas Jefferson is over here, and Thomas Jefferson is now in St. Louis, the big one. And the middle, and then there's Don Quixote back there, I think near the door, which is one of his more creative sculptures. And I think that's about it. Anybody have any questions? Yes. Yes, that's me. I mean, it's an imagined me, you know?
Oh, he looked like that.
Yeah.
My hair was combed, you see. Yes.
Tell the audience about your collection of old medical books.
Oh, no. Are you sure?
give him 30 seconds about your collection.
All right, when I was in medical school, I had to, my father shut me off because I took my, I don't know, how old was he, 6-month-old child to England for the summer because my mentor in Boston University Medical School, named Leonard Osler, wanted me to go to England. So I did, and my father had a fit and he shut me off. He wouldn't pay for anything. And so my mother used to ship me little tidbits of money. I borrowed $500 from my cousin Rachel, and I ate a lot of cereal with my wife and little fat baby. And they had some New Zealand lamb chops that were pretty good. And they were cheap, and we survived. And I ended up buying a library. I didn't have any money, but I, so there was this room in the Miller General Hospital that was full of old books and periodicals and everything, and they used to burn them, I think, during the Second World War, but there was still a huge collection of books. So I wrapped them all up with tea boxes and waterproof paper, mailed them all to my father. So when he came home from Boston one day to a living room absolutely packed full of books, and he was some furious. And then I ended up selling about $7,000 worth in the first 3 weeks of school that year to the various medical libraries in Boston. And so then he kind of got interested in the book business. And so he started, after a while I let him run the book business and I just dropped out of that part. Until recently, I started it up again, and it's been good. Any other questions? Yes. When they're not traveling, this is the first time they've traveled. This is the first time they've traveled, except the Thayer Academy. in a long time. They're in my barn in Marshfield, upstairs in a air-conditioned, heated space that my son Jonathan built for me up there.
Arthur, can you tell the students who gave Gauss a little bit more about her and about this gallery?
Sure. Before the art complex was built, Duxbury had the Bumpus Gallery, which is down near the schools. I don't know what they call it now. What do they call it?
It's the front of the DSU.
The what?
The Duxbury Student Union, that same building.
It's the same building. So that was the place where they, yeah, that's where she used to have these shows every single month of the year. And that's where I met all these nice artists, most of them. Yes.
Considering the Y of Fame, I would imagine that that picture by NC is, painted by NC is probably one of your most valuable.
It's hard to say. It's a half a painting. Well, they said it looked like an original, and Andrew Wyatt said it was an original, and
what'd your insurance company say?
I didn't talk to anybody.
Can I tell you something?
Yeah.
So another story about the NC Wyeth is that we had it up in Maine. It was framed. And we decided that it did have value, and so we should protect it because we're not there during the winter. And we hid it away. But then when we came back the next summer, we couldn't find it. And so we thought, well, maybe we did take it home. And then we thought, no, we didn't take it home. So we searched the whole house and we couldn't find it. And then we thought we were, you know, someone had taken it. And then one day our grandson, who was about 5, dropped something behind the couch, and there it was.
You're free to walk around the gallery.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Take a spin around and look at these. Luke Randall.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So, ahead.
I love people walking in front.
That's the Bruce Anderson.
No.
Oh, yeah. I'm just trying to work my way around the room in order. This is another Bruce Anderson with the classic dirigible in the back.
Does he put the dirigible in it all the time?
That's what Al said. There isn't a label there, so that's why I'm saying it, because I'm photographing the labels as I do this. Basically,
hey, how are
Hi, Charlie. How you doing?
Good. You?
Hi, Craig.
Hey, how are you?
This will all be on YouTube.
Are you in a movie?
Yeah, I
get
this.
Good.
I'll have this on YouTube. I'll send you the link when it's
okay.
Up there. Yeah.
So he did it on Portuguese, and we got talking, and he had the same exact accent. His voice continued that. A little bit of Massachusetts, and you look like Jonathan. He looks like you, actually. I know Jonathan very well. Did you? Does he have a
ESO. And here we are back at the beginning, where we started.